Good evening. Welcome to this Wednesday Holy Week reflection. If Tuesday of Holy Week is often known as Busy Tuesday, then Wednesday of Holy Week could be known as... It's not working. Can you go on to the next slide, please, Paul? Sorry. The suspense is amazing, isn't it? Could be known as Quiet Wednesday. We'll carry on. Oh, no, it's not that. It's not there. Okay, don't worry, Paul. Don't worry. It could be known as Quiet Wednesday. There it is, Silent Wednesday. I needed that to remind me what it was called. The Gospels record actually not a great deal of what happened on the Wednesday. It seems Jesus and his disciples didn't get up to too much, or at least not much that was recorded, possibly having a quiet day in preparation for the Passover festival, or perhaps Jesus did go back to the temple, although it's not recorded. Maybe Jesus took the opportunity to just spend some time with his disciples and to teach them more and to prepare them for what was coming up over the next few days as best he could. Whatever the precise details, we know that the Wednesday was a lot quieter than the Tuesday. For all the disciples except one, of course, Judas Iscariot, and we'll be thinking a little bit more about him and his actions later on. But as we begin this time together, let's come before God in prayer. Father God, we thank you for the opportunity that we have this evening to gather as your people and to reflect together on the events of Wednesday of Holy Week. Lord, as we hear your word, as we think upon it, please come and speak to us through your Spirit. Have your way with this time together, God, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite you to stand and we'll sing our first song, How Deep the Father's Love for Us.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, his sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there, until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in Jesus Christ, his death. His wounds have paid my ransom. Please do have a seat.
As we move towards a time of confession, let's listen to some words from Psalm 32. Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, and in whose spirit is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy on me, my strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Therefore let all the faithful pray to you while you may be found. Surely the rising of the mighty waters will not reach them. You are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. Many are the woes of the wicked, but the Lord's unfailing love surrounds the one who trusts in him. Some moments of silent confession. Your forgiveness is total. No notebook, tape recorder, or post-it note to remind you of that moment when. You take our confession offered with hands outstretched and gently, like the loving Heavenly Father that you are, put it to one side to be forgotten. No grudges, no itching for judgment, no resentment or ill will. Not like us who find it easy to say sorry, but so hard to forgive, absolutely. Forgive us, Father, that we are often more willing to accept forgiveness than to forgive, more willing to accept your love than to share it with those around us who have hurt us. Teach us to forgive as you forgive. Now, Lord, as we read your word, please speak to us through your Spirit. Amen. So a few verses from Matthew for us to reflect upon this evening. I'll read the verses and then there'll be some moments of quiet reflection. When Jesus had finished saying all these things, he said to his disciples, "As you know, the Passover is 2 days away, and the Son of Man will be handed over to be crucified." Then the chief priests and the elders of the people assembled in the palace of the high priest, whose name was Caiaphas, and they schemed to arrest Jesus secretly and kill him. But not during the festival, they said, or there may be a riot among the people. Matthew then, in his gospel, places the anointing of Jesus by the woman with the alabaster jar of perfume. Do you remember that story? At this point in the story. And then he continues. Then one of the 12, the one called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and asked, "What are you willing to give me if I deliver him over to you?" So they counted out for him 30 pieces of silver. From then on, Judas watched for an opportunity to hand him over. One of the things that our society has become ruthlessly adept at is building people up on pedestals only to knock them off again. Collectively, we see it in various different spheres in life, don't we? Public life, politics, sports, celebrity, all over the place. We build people up in hype and pile on pressures of hope and expectation. And then once we've built them up beyond anything which is humanly reasonable, we start to look for the cracks, the problems, the mistakes, the weaknesses which will see them come crashing down in a horrific collapse, which we can then shake our heads at and pass judgment upon, pretending we had absolutely nothing to do with any of it. Standing high in our ivory towers, we look down upon these fallen heroes with disdain. As we reflect on Judas Iscariot, perhaps we're tempted to do the same. Our world loves a villain, doesn't it? We like to have someone we can put the blame on, a scapegoat, a fool guy or girl. See it all the time with my children in innocent ways. Something is noticed by Caroline or myself that has gone wrong around the house. And we say, "Who did that?" And they'll point the finger at each other. It's never, "Oh, yeah, it was me." But life is rarely that simple, is it? To have one person upon whom we can pin the blame. Even if people are at fault, there's usually a story to be told. Complex backgrounds to be investigated. Our snap judgments and ill-informed opinions are usually found wanting upon further investigation. So what about Judas? Well, there's a few things that we know about him. First of all, he was a southerner. All of the rest of the disciples were from the north. And Jesus had spent most of his ministry up in the north. His family was from Nazareth. And he spent a lot of time around the Sea of Galilee, ministering around there, up in the north of the country. But Judas was from way down in the south of Jerusalem, they think, anyway. So it would be a bit like all of the rest of the disciples and Jesus coming from Liverpool, Manchester and Sheffield, whilst Judas was from Carshalton Beeches. Different accents, different lifestyles, different upbringing. Maybe he didn't get a lot of the in jokes. Maybe he always felt like an outsider. Maybe he never really felt like part of the group at all. Or maybe he looked down on those northerners, as many of his fellow southerners did at the time. The Gospels tell us that Judas was placed in charge of the communal purse for Jesus and his disciples. So he was trusted. We don't know the details, but You wouldn't put your money in the hands of someone you didn't trust, would you? The Gospels also tell us that Judas had a habit of giving money to the poor. But we should remember that the other disciples didn't suspect a thing at the time. When Jesus sat with them at the Last Supper and told them one of them would betray him, they all said, "Surely not I, Lord." So it wasn't like a pantomime. Every time Judas entered the scene, the boos. Several people think that Judas may have been a zealot. The zealots believed that if they turned Israel back to God and incited war against the Romans, the Messiah would come. He would arise and lead them and establish his kingdom. Many of the zealots were actually very excited by Jesus and his early teaching, and especially the miracles he performed, because it spoke to them about the kingdom of God. But as Jesus' teaching continued, and especially as he neared his final week, as Jesus began to speak more and more about his upcoming suffering and death, maybe this all became too much for Judas the zealot, if he was a zealot. Maybe he became so disappointed and disillusioned with all this talk of suffering and death that he turned against Jesus. Maybe he was trying to force Jesus' hand, as many others had done, to make him rise up against the Romans and take his rightful place as Messiah. We don't know for sure. Seems Judas never meant for Jesus to be crucified. The Gospels record that Judas handed him over to be, you know, that he betrayed him and that he was crucified. But at the time, we know the rest of the story, don't we? At the time, Judas made one decision. Maybe he was naive. Maybe he was duped by the religious leaders. Whatever. The precise facts. Have you ever been in that situation where you make one bad decision and it leads to another and another and another and the consequences go on and on? I think probably all of us have. Judas couldn't cope with the extent of the consequences of his actions and tragically ended up taking his own life. And I can't help but think, if only he'd waited a few more days. If only he'd clung on for a bit longer. Maybe he would have been forgiven and reinstated along with Peter and the others. Let's remember, after all, that all of the disciples betrayed Jesus. Maybe you know what it feels like to be at the end of your tether, feeling like the world would be better off without you. Maybe for some, you're feeling that way right now. Well, if that's you, please hold on. Please don't give up. God is with you. He does love you. He will forgive you, as he's forgiven all of us. God is a God of second chances, and third chances, and fourth chances, and fifth chances, and carry on, and on, and on. Because he loves us. He has placed his image within us. We bear the image of God. He loves us as we are his children. He wants to give us another chance. It's far too easy to point the finger of judgment at Judas without any regard for how we may see ourselves in him. Yes, his portrayal of Jesus was horrific. And yes, it was his choice. And yes, his actions were most certainly wrong. But I tell you what, there but for the grace of God go I. As Judas walks away from Jesus and the others on Wednesday of Holy Week, I'm quite sure he had no idea about how far that road would lead him. And as I look back over my own life, maybe it's the same for you. I can think of times when I've walked away from Jesus. In word, in deed, in thought. If I point the finger of judgment at Judas, I see three more fingers pointing back at me. So I think the story of Judas should actually lead other than climbing my haughty ivory tower of judgment. But there's more here too as well, isn't there? There's a question which comes to mind as we consider the events of today. If Jesus knew that Judas would betray him, why didn't he have Judas removed? Why didn't he turn his back on Judas? Jesus not turning his back on Judas reveals himself as the God who not only desires to be with us when we do the right thing, but God who also wants to be with us in all aspects of our lives. Yes, he wants us to do the right thing because that's best for us and all those around us, but he does not desert us if we make mistakes, if we do the wrong thing, if we make bad choices, if we make wrong decisions, if we do things which are just wrong. He does not forsake us. In Jesus, we meet a God who desires that we reach. We do not meet a God who desires that we reach some state of perfection before he will be there for us. Rather, we find a God who is willing to work with us as we journey through life as real, flawed human beings. In Jesus, we find a God who desires to be with us as we make that journey. And our journey may well, at times, be challenging, extremely challenging. We may stumble and fall. We may take wrong turns. We may make wrong decisions. We may do things which we shouldn't do and say things which we shouldn't say and think things which we shouldn't think. But God will not give up on us. God is determined to be with us, and he wants us to be with him. More than this, even, we find a God who will go to the cross for us, even though he knows we have betrayed him, deserted him, disowned him, and ultimately even killed him. Oh, what a Savior. What amazing grace. As we said last night, we find a Savior who loves us too much to leave us as we are. God who will work with us through his Spirit to bring healing, restoration, new life. A God who can never even use our very worst acts. A God who can even use our very worst acts to bring about his kingdom purposes. Through the betrayal of Jesus, through the crucifixion, God offers salvation to all creation, to all humanity. There's another reason as well, perhaps, why Jesus did not have Judas removed to prevent him from being able to betray Jesus. And it's because Jesus knew that he had to go to the cross in order to save us. And that's incredible, isn't it? This is who God is. His love is so great that he's willing to die himself in order that we may be saved. If only Jesus had clung on for a little longer, I am convinced that Jesus would have forgiven him and restored him, just as he did with the other disciples and just as he does with us. This is the real tragedy of Judas Iscariot. Not that he made the mistake, not that he made the wrong decision, not that he betrayed Jesus, but that he took his own life because he couldn't live with his mistake. I'm sure that breaks God's heart. J. Judas couldn't get past his own guilt. And received the forgiveness and life that Jesus died and rose again to give us all. Let's do all we can not to make that mistake ourselves and to ensure those around us don't. God loves us. Let's reflect now in silence upon his love. We thank you, Lord, for your love for us. Love which knows no bounds. Love which is truly limitless. Love which pursues us even when we run away. Love which forgives. Love which restores. Love which transforms. Thank you that in and through your love we find identity and self-worth and meaning and purpose for our lives. Thank you for Jesus Christ, our Saviour. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before we have opportunity to go around the prayer stations, we're going to stand and sing again, "Thank You for Saving Me." And then as you go around, or sit in your seat, or sit by the cross, whatever you want, however you want to use the time, I'll be playing on the piano. Should we stand together to sing, "Thank You for Saving Me"?
Thank You for saving me. What can I say? You are my everything, and I will sing Your praise. You shed Your blood for me. What can I say? Took my sin and shame, a sinner called by name. Great is the Lord, so great. Truth has set us free. You've set Your hope in me. Mercy and grace are mine, forgiven is my sin. Jesus, my only hope, Savior of the world. Great is the Lord, we cry, God, let Your kingdom come. Your word has let me see, thank You for saving me. So great.